We have already seen a few sentences in the beginning of this section. We'll quickly run through them to catch the continuity. And Savitri too awoke among these tribes that hastened to join the brilliant Samana's chant and lured with beauty the apparent way, acclaimed their portion of ephemeral joy. Savitri too awoke among these tribes. Tribes we have already seen in the course of evolution of life, right from the beginning, prana, right from the beginning, Pashu, then Pishacha, Rakshasa, Asura, Devas, Siddhas, man, all the things. So it is these tribes which have advanced to the mental status. It is among them Savitri has awoken, that hastened to join the brilliant Samana's chant. Brilliant Samana, I mean, in the context of the story as is going on, is of course the sun god. But I would say that it has a much deeper significance, deeper occult content in it than just the sun god, you see. It is the coming of the avatar who would compel Savitri to come and awake. It is the avatar Ashwapati who will come and summon her to do her work, you see. That hastened to join the Samana's chant and lured with the apparent ways of the apparent, and lured with the beauty of the apparent way, acclaimed their portion of ephemeral joy. There, of course, all those tribes. Means Savitri has completely accepted the conditions of the evolution at that point of time, and her work now begins from that point onward. Akin to the eternity when she came. This is a clear statement that Savitri belongs to the Supreme. Our Savitri's coming here is the incarnation of the Supreme Shakti herself. Akin to the eternity when she came. Akin, why? Because she has taken the mortal birth. Even in the mortal birth, she is akin. She is connected with the eternity when she came. No part she took in this small happiness. In other words, even in this world of smallness, littleness, she is always in the joy, happiness of the eternal world from which she is coming here. No part she took means she is always with that joy. A mighty stranger in the human field. Obviously for us, she will look like a stranger here. The embodied guest within made no response. The Supreme Savitri, the Divine Savitri, who has taken the mortal birth, she is seated in her soul there, and she is doing her work from within, and therefore she does not take part in all the outer activities at all, you see. It is the human Savitri who... You have to see Savitri in three states. Basically, you have to see Savitri in three states. Savitri, the mortal being, as a human. Then, the Savitri within her, the soul of Savitri, and the counterpart of the soul in the transcendent, the Supreme Savitri. So, we have actually three levels of Savitri, so to say. The mortal Savitri, the immortal Savitri in the mortal Savitri, and beyond all of them, the transcendent Savitri, the Supreme Savitri in her realm of Satchidananda, or even beyond that. The call that wakes the leap of human mind, the call that wakes the leap of human mind. Now, because she has taken this mortal birth, she also goes by the call of the beings who are awakened by the thing, man, etc., etc. Its checkered eager motion of pursuit, its fluttering illusion of desire, visited her heart like a sweet alien note. Well, it comes here because she is already awake in a certain sense, and therefore it is an alien note for her, you see, that call. In other words, she gets up early morning, so to say, and starts her work, her activity, her day begins, her action in the field starts happening now here. But she is participating in them always with that consciousness. The divine consciousness is never lost in her while she is still working in the human consciousness. Visited her heart like a sweet alien note. Time's message of brief light was not for her. This is one of the most dramatic lines also seen. In her, there was the anguish of the gods, imprisoned in our transient human mold. The deathless conquered the death of time. Now there is a little complication here, and I think maybe at least we can point out the complication. If you not resolve the complication is, in her heart there was the anguish of the god imprisoned in our transient human mold. Now who is imprisoned? Who is imprisoned? Are these gods who are imprisoned, or it is the anguish which is imprisoned? You see. Gods are imprisoned, yeah. Well, that is.
In our mold, we have the God involved.
But they are already within us, it means, and they are trapped.
Maybe we have anguish of God, but we have the God. First, we have the God before.
Well, actually, most of the authors who have written about it, they say it is the gods who are imprisoned. I don't know. I don't know. See, if the gods are already imprisoned within us, then there is a question of their anguish, so to say. See, anguish is something to strive to do something out of. See, I would rather say it is the anguish that is imprisoned within us. The anguish of the gods which is imprisoned within us. The gods have some concern for us. The gods are worried about our future, about the prospects we should come here. They are there in the transcendent, in their own world. And yet they are helping man, they are helping everybody in their own manner. They are concerned about it. That is the anguish they have. It is that anguish which is imprisoned in the human mold of Savitri. You see.
Completely different meaning.
Pardon me? Yeah. See, I mean. Yeah.
We are saving Savitri.
The anguish of the gods imprisoned is a very big orchestrate. Not the, see, the what is it that got them trapped in mind, in human beings? You need some kind of a background history of their getting trapped in the human mold for them to be imprisoned. But the gods certainly do have concern about the evolutionary process. They are helping their own manner from the world. They are helping man and promoting man's activities so that he makes spiritual progress. So that is their concern, that is their anguish, that is their desire, that is their job, so to say, also of the gods. And therefore in her there, and Savitri is definitely carrying that anguish in her to take man forward, to build up a new future for him. You see, in her there was the anguish of the gods, imprisoned in our transient human mold, the deathless conquered by the death of thing. Now, deathless here stands for Savitri, of course. Now, conquered with the death of thing, because she has taken a mortal birth. She has accepted the mortality, all the circumstances of mortality, and she has to work out whatever she has to work out. Through this mortality, she always being deathless. She always be. See, this line, the deathless conquered with the death of thing, well, does not really go well with gods. Gods are immortal, not deathless. Gods are immortal, not deathless. They become deathless if they take birth in man, in the mortal world. There is a difference between they being immortal and they being deathless. Actually, no. Actually, in the possibilities of a new race, the Gnostic race, the future race, as being worked out by Shemindu and the mother, it is the deathlessness which is important, and not immortality.
Yes, exactly, because we are still alive.
Not immortality. You have taken birth in the mortal world, you have to become deathless here in the mortal world. not immortal, you see. Immortality means you kind of get frozen to a certain type of activity and don't make really progress. Deathlessness makes you progress also continuously further and further. Deathlessness means also if you want to give up, you can give up also, you see. You are neither bound by death nor bound by deathlessness. A vast nature of joy had once been hers. Well, this is again an indication that she has come from eternity. Vast nature. Brahat Prakriti. Vast means Brahat. Supernature. Joy had once been hers. Well, before she has entered into the mortal world and taken the mortal birth, she was the denizen of the celestial world, of heaven. And she was always there, enjoying all the possibilities of supernature there, you see. She was happy there, but long could keep not its gold heavenly hue. Gold heavenly hue, her deathless, her superior nature, you see. Her gold heavenly hue, but could not long, could not, but long could not its gold heavenly hue. In other words, because she has taken the mortal birth, it is that heavenly character which is there is not able to assert itself here always permanently. It has to accept the conditions of mortality, the circumstance of ignorance and death and suffering and fate, and then make a move forward. Therefore, long could keep not its gold heavenly hue, because she has to accept this thing. She has to work out whatever has to be worked out in these circumstances, or stand upon this brittle earthly base. Her nature could not stand upon earthly base. Now, this is an important line, important statement also. The earthly base is brittle. The cosmic foundation itself is not firm, is not powerful enough to hold the possibilities of the spirit in it. Now, or stand upon this brittle earthly, who is going to make it strong, firm, remove its brittleness? Who is going to remove that thing? It is the Divine Himself who will come here as an avatar and prepare the base for Savitri so that her earthly base becomes strong, firm for her activity, for her action, you see. That is why you have first the coming of Ashwapati as the avatar. Ashwapati comes here, he does three things basically. He explores all the cosmic dimensions. Of course, he liberates himself first from the mortality in which he has taken the birth. His soul is free, his spirit is free. Now he can go and move anywhere he likes. So first is the individual tapasya of individual yoga of Ashwapati, which makes him free. Now with that freedom, he can now move anywhere in the cosmic worlds. All the worlds he is now climbing up one above. That is what we have got in book 2. He is climbing up. Now he is climbing up, and then ultimately, of course, he is going to meet the Divine Mother there and pray to her, please come down here. So this is the thing. But before that, while he is climbing up, he has already established in the transcendent the new creation for which he has taken the birth. Now, in order to bring down that new creation, she has to take the birth. She has to come down here as Savitri and do the work, you see. And in order that she does that work here, he has to prepare the base, the earthly base. That earthly base is when he is going now from plane to plane through all these worlds, world above worlds, he is leaving behind him his presence and power, his Shakti, his Astitva. He is leaving behind everywhere. Yes, I am here, 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 I am here now, Supra Sesi. And it is that now become the solid foundation, the support, the Adhara for Savitri to do her work. Or stand upon this brittle earthly, that earthly base is now made really firm, solid, so that she can do her work, you see. Without Ashwapati's yoga, Savitri's coming here has no meaning really. In fact, the whole thing will get crushed if she comes directly like that, you see. The spiritual base is important. That occult foundation has to be built. That luminous occult foundation is important, you see.